Penguin Random House Audio presents River of Fire, My Spiritual Journey. This is the author, Sister Helen Prejean, CSJ. For my beloved community, the Sisters of St. Joseph, and Sister Margaret Maggio, CSJ, sister, friend, and co-worker. Ask not for understanding, ask for the fire. Saint Bonaventure. Preface. They killed a man with fire one night, strapped him in an oaken chair, and pumped electricity into his body until he was dead. His killing was a legal act. No religious leaders protested the killing that night. But I was there. I saw it with my own eyes. And what I saw set my soul on fire, a fire that burns in me still. In the 1980s, I was living in an African-American housing project in New Orleans called St. Thomas. This was a departure from my previous life as a Sister of St. Joseph, largely spent among white suburban Catholics, teaching in Catholic schools or directing religious education in Catholic parishes. I had joined the congregation of the Sisters of St. Joseph at the age of 18, inspired, like many other young women of that era, by a desire to serve God with my whole mind, soul, and heart. At the time, we had a clear idea of what that meant, but times would change. First came the transformative event in the Catholic Church of a global council called Vatican II, 1962-65, that inspired women religious to return to the Gospels and rethink their mission in response to the needs of the world. And then gradually I underwent my own transformation, following a path first charted by Jesus that led to the poor and to those who many dismiss as throwaway people. One day I received a request to correspond with a prisoner on death row. I didn't know that in responding to that request, I would be taking the first steps on a path that would forever transform my life. That journey culminated in my book, Dead Man Walking, 1993, which was made into an Academy Award-winning film by Tim Robbins, 1995. Suddenly, I was thrust into public debate and soon found myself known as the death penalty abolitionist nun. Once, when I was inside the Louisiana death house awaiting an execution, Captain John Rabelais, a guard, asked, "What's a nun doing in a place like this?" Here is an account of my journey to the killing chamber that night and the spiritual currents that pulled me there. It's a river I'm riding. I invite you to pitch your boat into its current and come with me. Introduction. What it's always been about for me is the spiritual energy, the power that flows through us, lights us up, and enlivens whatever we touch. For me, that energy has always been connected to God. Call it mystery. Call it grace. Call it the luminous center we touch sometimes and don't know what to call it, but we know that being in its presence fills us with confidence and peace. I learned as a child that I was created to love God with my whole heart and mind and soul, and to love my neighbor as myself. And Jesus, God's Son, would show me how to do it. And the goal of it all, to make it through this life so I could be happy with God forever in heaven. Getting to heaven was really, really big. Catholics call it the beatific vision, seeing God face to face. Wouldn't it be wonderful to love God so much that I wouldn't be selfish ever again or obsess about myself and what I need and what I want and what I feel? Wouldn't it be drop-dead wonderful? A requirement, actually, the dropping dead, to be so free of ego? Just imagine being so on fire with love of God that I could be a martyr and sing and make jokes even while they're torturing me. Like St. Lawrence on the gridiron being roasted to death and quipping to his executioners, "I think I'm done on this side, time to turn me over." Now that's what I call spiritual power. At the age of 18, I chucked every worldly pleasure I knew to pursue it. I entered the convent to become a nun. Needless to say, convent life in the late 1950s was a very different kind of world. How different? Maybe this description of our life back then can help ease you in. A young woman entering a Roman Catholic religious congregation expected that most things would remain the same for the rest of her life. Once she chose a nun's vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience, she would have very few decisions to make, ever again, about our lifestyle and work. Upon arising each morning, she would put on a long and flowing black, brown, or white dress and the medieval-style head wrap and veil that the members of her order had donned for generations. She would eat meals in silence, with the sisters seated in order of rank. Standardized prayers would be recited at the convent at specific times throughout the day. She would be assigned work as a nurse or a teacher in a Catholic hospital or school, but other activities outside the convent, including family visits, would be rare and highly regulated. Contact with laypersons would be restricted to workplaces and medical visits. Superiors could open and review the letters she received and wrote. The sister would be required to ask her superior, in ritualized fashion, for permission to use objects such as soap, stationery, and thread. Exclusive, that is, particular friendships with other sisters would be discouraged for fear that they would undermine community harmony. The standard manual for sisters, A Catechism of the Vows, explained that this highly regulated life best fixed the sister in a direction that steered her toward perfect union with God. The constant discipline and regulation would, ideally, mold the sister into an interior woman who concentrated her attention on the bringing about of the perfection of her soul through an overcoming of herself in the ways of the world, both of which were related to temptation and sin. As a symbol of the surrendering of an old self, a young sister would be given a new name upon profession as a novice. As the bishop granted the new name, he would typically pronounce, "Behold, the new name, which I give you on God's part to enable you to overcome the devil, the world, and yourself." The purpose of the vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience, but most especially obedience, was to help protect her from the three objects of human concupiscence, namely, riches, sensual pleasures, and the irregular love of her own ideas. Through constantly practiced, freely given obedience to superiors in matters large and small, she would learn to overcome every inclination to self-will and therefore be a finer instrument of God's will. Through the practice of humble obedience, she would kill the greatest tyrant, the greatest enemy of perfection, her disordered and unruly self. Dara Muldary, What Human Goodness Entails, An Intellectual History of U.S. Catholic Sisters, 1930 to 1980, Ph.D. Dissertation, Brandeis University, 2006, pages 1 and 2. That is a good description of the world I encountered when I joined the Sisters of St. Joseph. As if a purely sociological description could ever capture a way of life that for many centuries had produced its fair number of loving, generous beings and mystics. But that world would change, and so would I.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.